created a web developer with over 18 years' experience in commercial and corporate environments. He's worked at senior, lead and technical director level for the likes of Ginger Media Group, Time Inc. and Viacom. He's also built the online presence for brands such as MTV, NME, BET, Comedy Central, Nickelodeon, Tier 5, goes on, doesn't it? There's quite a few here. Tier 5 Friday, Paramount, Wallpaper and Virgin Radio. But I know him best for him headlining at Glastonbury, as I found out last year when we had a drink at the pub. So, what's the name of the band again, Paul?
It was called Paris Motel.
Oh, it was called Paris Motel, but they're very good. They're still on Spotify. And one of their tracks was featured on True Detective?
No, it was Walking Dead.
The Walking Dead? Can you believe it? Anyway, enough about that. He's also very good at brutal stuff. So without any further delay, I will hand you over to Paul Reeves.
Hello. I was going to do a brief introduction to myself, but there's been one done already, mostly. But I kind of fell into web development around about the late 90s, just through someone I knew that worked in media. And I seem to have been kind of, I guess, lucky in that I've sort of moved around the industry, just as the particular company that I was working for was going through digital transformation. So the earliest example was Virgin Radio, which is my first employer. That was sort of 98 that I started there, and that was just at a time when we were starting to do online streaming and people were moving away from FM AM models and moving into digital listening online and stuff. And then around 2001 I moved into publishing at IPC Media, which is part of Time Warner. And they were obviously going through a whole, print was dying, people weren't buying magazines or newspapers anymore, moving online. And then I took a few years off to do music and pretend to be a rock and roll star. And then I joined Viacom in 2007. And so that was when, I first sort of started working with Drupal, but also they were going through the digital transformation there as well. More and more people were starting to watch, video on their laptops or handheld devices, and moving away from watching TV. Obviously, MTV had its own transformation in moving away from music and stuff, but I'll talk less about that. I wasn't really sure what I was going to talk about today. I thought, I'll kind of talk about some of my experiences with Drupal, I guess. I don't think many people might be talking about Drupal today, funnily enough. But as it turns out, Andre Spice has talked before me about collective stupidity. My talk seems to follow on quite nicely from that, in that I will be talking about some of the mistakes that have been made throughout my time working with Drupal. And I guess that collective stupidity within large organisations is particularly appropriate. I will take credit for some of the stupid mistakes that have been made and silly decisions and stuff. So that's quite a long title for a talk. So I went with Drupal and I. And it's just, obviously this is purely subjective. It's from, my personal viewpoint. Actually, Viacom can't sack me anymore, so I can say what I like, pretty much. So 2007 was when I first met Drupal. This was MTV Flux. So this actually launched in 2006, so about a year before I joined. It was built by an agency, who were a relatively small agency called Lullabot back then, who obviously went on to bigger and better things. So this is quite ahead of its time, really. This MTV Flux was an interactive TV channel. So it was kind of, I think it was billed as the next MySpace or MySpace on TV. It suffered pretty much the same fate as MySpace. But the idea was is that people could sort of, log into the website and, create their social media profiles, and this would then feed back into the TV. They could upload, they could make their own music videos. This went through various sort of transcoding work streams and ended up on TV, so they were sort of building their own TV channel. I hated Drupal. I'd never heard of Drupal before I joined Volcom, and I hated it with a passion once I met it. This is, I think, primarily because my background was in building my own applications, you know. So I was a coder. I loved to write code and, you know, build things. The idea of sort of using a platform that someone else had built was like, well, how could this possibly work for me? You know, every sort of situation is unique. You know, how could they possibly understand the needs of the business that I work in? Which was incredibly naive opinion to have at the time. I lost my train of thought. I spent a lot of time kind of looking around at, you know, how can we move away from Drupal? The version of Drupal that we're using, I'm not going to badmouth Lollipop for the work that they did, because, you know, it was incredibly ahead of its time. This was around sort of Drupal 4.6, 4.7 kind of time. There were lots of performance issues with running at the sort of scale that we were attempting to run it at. We hacked it to pieces, which subsequently meant that there was no upgrade path for us. Really, we couldn't sort of take advantage of improvements to the software and to the system. So we were kind of stuck with this version of Drupal that we had sort of set in stone around 2006, 2007. There was a kind of turning point for me really in 2008 when I went to DrupalCon Boston. And that was the point really that I was sold on Drupal. And a lot of it, you know, it was partly because of, you know, seeing the improvements to Drupal 5 and, you know, how much better the system it was. You know, there were a lot of, you know, improvements to Drupal that Viacom had actually contributed to, you know, via Lullabot. That then went into Drupal 5. You know, performance was much better. But the thing that really sold me on it was the community, sort of meeting these hundreds, thousands of developers who were all, you know, sharing their knowledge, sharing their experience, all contributing to the greater good and that kind of stuff. It made me feel, I guess, less like a sort of corporate bad guy. The community aspect was really sort of sold me on it. So we went back and we started working on Drupal 5, and this was around about the time of the Drupal 6 release. It wasn't quite ready, you know, sort of production ready. But this was our first Drupal 5 build that we released. I believe it was around 2009. It was about a 6-month build with an internal, you know, purely internal team. We made lots of mistakes. But, you know, we were learning, and, you know, we were actually starting to understand the power of Drupal, how it can actually work for us. We had a few builds along the way. I think I'm just realising my short's going to be really, the talk is going to be really short, so sorry. We had a few builds on the way, so there were a couple of other channels that we were building websites for. This was Viva, which is running on Drupal 6. We built an on-demand, interview on-demand, on Drupal 6 as well. So we were starting to, as we sort of started going through the versions, we realized that the core of Drupal was progressing so much that we didn't actually need to do a lot of the custom work that we'd had to do before. So during the Drupal 5 build, probably about 50% of the build was actually spent on improving the admin and editorial experience and building those custom modules for drag and drop and all of this kind of stuff. And then once we started using Drupal 6, it's like, okay, but there's actually, you know, we've probably shaved months off of a complete site build by upgrading to the latest version. You know, there were solutions to these problems that other people have already found. We were using Drupal on TV as well. So Drupal was used as, I mean, it was primarily an admin interface, putting metadata into a system, which we'd then, you know, spit out on TV for running little quizzes and factlets about Brian Adams. Right up to 2011 was when we started working on Drupal 7. And this was our first good decision, but kind of bad decision that we made into, okay, you know, the rise of mobile and tablet and everything was, you know, starting to accelerate. So we needed to actually be able to cater for this. We couldn't
get away with just grabbing, you know, desktop sites anymore. So this was a really good project for us. We learned a lot for it, but one of the fatal mistakes that we made was actually building three separate versions of the site rather than, you know, a single responsive version. And I'll probably cover that a little bit more later. 2012, so this was after we'd done our first Drupal 7 build. And we started, these statistics here are the share of mobile users during 2012, and you can see the rise. This is just, you know, across a 4-month period, 1% increase, 3% increase, and then a 4% increase. So we were seeing this kind of steady rise of mobile share. So we were still running on Drupal 5, which was a desktop-only site, and we were supporting, you know, sort of data feeds into apps, mobile devices and stuff as well. But really, you know, our bread and butter was with this, the desktop site still that, you know, was years old by this point. Combined with that, the responsibility of the team had grown. So when I joined Varka, we were just looking after MTB UK. It was pretty much just one website. By 2012, we were looking after multiple brands across multiple territories. But we're also working on multiple platforms as well. So even though, you know, Drupal was our main focus, we still had to support .NET websites, Java websites, Zen Framework, across all of the different brands. So we really needed to kind of try and standardize, you know, our platforms, you know, across everything. Obviously, Drupal was the answer to this. I've recycled some of these slides from previous talks, so this is almost be like a post-mortem of some projects that I've talked about before. But so this was a kind of a solution that we come up with, which ended up looking a little bit like this. So we'd built a HubSpoke content network, I guess it was. By far the biggest challenge we had was data migration. So we probably spent probably 6, 7, 8 months just migrating all of our data in from all of these other sites. But the idea was is that there would be a single CMS, which was running on Drupal, that all of our editorial staff could use, and then we would push content out to all of the separate Drupal websites that were also Drupal. So this really sort of helps us because even when we were using Drupal, you know, across different websites, we'd be running on different versions, or, you know, we'd build something for MTV UK, and then, you know, the Viva guys would say, oh, we really like that feature you're running on MTV. Can we have it, please? And they're like, well, no, you can't. MTV's running on Drupal 5, you're running on Drupal 6, you know, so there was no kind of portability of these features, there was no sort of parity between them. So the idea was to sort of standardize our whole network and still have a, you know, different look and feel, but we'd have like a Drupal distribution with a global base theme, and then we could have brand or language sub-themes. So you could have a core, you know, Drupal site, but it would actually look like Comedy Central, or it would look like MTV, or it would look like, you know, Paramount Channel. So previously, where we'd be looking at like sort of 6-month build times at a minimum for a new website. And there'd be the usual, you know, working on all of the admin tools and then working on the front end of the site. We were starting to get to a point where we could actually bring a new brand on board within weeks, you know, or sometimes even days, if, you know, depending on the complexity of the requirements. So we had this, you know, this huge acceleration that we had, you know, rather than having a 6-month project for a complete rebuild, you know, to get that down to weeks or days was incredible. Once a brand was on board, we'd get to a point where we could have a new site, like sometimes within a few hours. It was, you know, and there was still a lot of sort of manual work that was going into this. If we'd have had automation in it, probably could have been like self-service click of a button, and there you go, you've got a new website, you know. But yeah, I mean, this is incredible. I think the overall sort of build time to get this, you know, to get the foundations of this was probably around 18 months. So it was a significant investment. And especially given that we were only sort of given about 3 months to build this initial platform and enough budget for about 3 months worth of work as well. So we went significantly over budget and significantly over time. We probably were about this close to being sacked. But, you know, very quickly, I think, you know, the business started to see the benefits of everything we put in place, and it actually started paying dividends. So before long, the network actually started to look like this. You know, we had obviously MTV, Comedy Central, Paramount Channel in Romania and Hungary. Nickelodeon used it, for some of their smaller sites out in Australia. We still had the occasional site on Java that would be supporting, and a lot of the Nickelodeon stuff was still running on Java. But across the international, we started to, spread this Drupal distribution out across the different brands and the different regions. I think at some point we had, six brands and 10 languages and 29 countries, I think, that were running off of a single distribution. And this was managed by a team of, I think we averaged at about 5 or 6 people in the internal team. We did have some help along the way, so Brightlemon helped us within, the early stages of development. We also had Agile Collective come in and do some fantastic work with the multilingual stuff, and Wunder Kraut, spent probably about a year with us working on the Comedy Central rebuild. Excuse me. And they sort of really helped us move away from that, desktop, tablet, mobile versions of the site into the fully responsive themes that are still running on the network today. But touching back on that, the responsive versus device specific, I think when we did an audit for the MTV redesign at one point, and we were trying to do a component audit. How many actual individual components are we going to be building to achieve this? And we realised, I think there was like 150 or 160 separate components that we were trying to build within a 3-month time period, which was insane, And you'd have like exactly the same little block that would look very slightly different if it was on tablet, and very slightly different if it was on mobile, and then different again if it was on just, a different section of the website. So it was really kind of streamlining what it was we were trying to build, the core of the platform, streamlining the components, but also making them fully responsive. So rather than building 3 versions of, 50 different components, it was more like actually one version of 20 different components. So it made the whole platform much more scalable. But a key role in this was the product owner. So our product owner really played a key role in the development of this entire platform. He was that kind of, I hate to call him a middleman, because it's, it has sort of negative connotations, but really he kind of sat in between the business and the technology teams. So he was the one who understood all the business needs, but understood the capabilities of the technology platform and what it was that we were trying to achieve. And we found that that role was kind of crucial to adoption within the rest of the business. We tended to do much better with the smaller parts of the business that didn't necessarily have the budget to fund their own development. So Viacom is kind of a strange beast of an organisation in that, it's a global organisation, and a lot of the local regions have a fair bit of autonomy. So MTV UK can historically do a lot of things very different to what MTV US does, or MTV France, Germany, Israel, And it wasn't like kind of warring factions or anything like that, but, each individual market had its own needs. Some markets were sort of pay TV, some were terrestrial TV. So the idea was is that even though you'd have these global brands, the local teams could really adapt those brands to fit the business needs of the local market. And this, resulted in the markets or the territories that were generating more money tended to have their own tech teams. So the guys in Berlin were all using Ruby on Rails. The Milan team were using, a mixture of WordPress and then later Symfony 2. And then all of the guys in domestic work, even, you know, even though that was North America, you would have Nickelodeon who were using Java, who later moved on to Node.js. You'd have MTV that were using a mixture of Java and WordPress, and Comedy Central was using a bespoke PHP framework that had been homegrown and, you know, developed over about 8 years or so internally. So you had this real mix across the entire network. There was much more of a move towards globalization. We wanted to kind of standardize, we wanted to be able to share things, not just within, you know, local regions. You know, and we've already seen huge benefits, like we developed a feature for Comedy Central UK, and the MTV guys have said, that's brilliant, we really want to be able to use that, and we'd just be able to enable it on their profile. So suddenly, you know, rather than having to, you know, have a small team of 4 to 6 people who had to prioritize, okay, this month we're working on MTV, now we're going to be working on Comedy Central next month, we could say, well, hold on, we're going to develop this feature and we're going to be able to roll it out across the entire network. So we were seeing huge benefits for standardization. But other parts of the business were sort of more difficult, I guess, to try to persuade into our way of thinking. And so this became really evident when there was a change within the organisation to make it more that we're going to have a global engineering structure and a global, you know, IT structure across the whole of Viacom. And so all of the different systems for all the different regions were kind of, you know, evaluated. There was the Drupal system, you know, Ruby on Rails. Some of the Java systems were sort of evaluated as well. It's like, okay, what is going to be the standard platform that we use across the entire organization? And this is when one of the things that we found that actually what we'd ended up creating was this monolith. This, you know, even though we had this kind of network of sites, and, you know, we had this separation between the front end and the content management systems, it was actually the dependencies between everything was incredibly complex. We had a severe lack of documentation, which is, you know, one of the, I guess, you know, downsides of being such a small team is that, you know, it was all hands on deck to get, you know, roll out new features, get new things built. We very rarely spent any time on documentation. And a lot of time we felt that we didn't need to because we were just talking amongst ourselves. If you didn't understand how something worked, you could spin around and say, hey, Alistair, how does that work? And he would tell you. Or he would pick up a task for you. But there was also a lack of automated testing as well. I'm looking again at Luke because we had several fights about automated testing. Early on in the sort of life cycle of the platform, you know, we could get away with doing manual releases, and it might take us a day to do a manual release, but we could get away with doing that because we were working on a handful of sites. But we'd be, you know, relying on someone noticing if there was a problem. So because we had this kind of shared platform that was going across all of the different brands, you know, what tended to happen is that you might be working on a feature for MTV Australia, and then accidentally that feature would go out across Comedy Central New Zealand, you know, and no one would notice maybe for days. And then someone would pick it up and then you'd fix it and you'd work around it. But really kind of automated testing would have played a vital role in actually sort of stopping those mistakes from happening. But the other sort of downside of the monolithic architecture that we created is it made it very difficult just to work on one part of the system. So, you know, if you were working, because there was shared code between the central CMS and all of these front-end sites, if you were working on, a new feature or an issue on the CMS, that could accidentally leak out into the front-end as well. So you really needed to understand the entire monolith to actually just work on a very small part of it. That became a huge barrier to adoption as well, you know, so you'd have non-Drupal teams that would come on board that wouldn't just need to learn how to use Drupal, but they'd also then need to learn, you know, what it is that we've created, this beast that we've created with Drupal. And also from a support and maintenance perspective, this resulted in, you know, the core development team handling most of the support. There were, you know, teams that were set up within the organisation to handle frontline support for you, but you'd have to give them a runbook. You'd have to say, if this is this problem, this is how you can diagnose the issue. And to do that, you needed to give them the Drupal manual and then the Viacom Drupal manual for them to work, you know, to kind of debug any issues. So it meant that the core development team actually just got bogged down doing the support stuff and day-to-day running of this entire network. Which, you know, it kind of resulted, not necessarily, it wasn't necessarily a stagnation of development, but certainly meant that we were spending a lot more time sort of debugging, you know, small issues when we actually could have been, you know, refactoring or, you know, improving the entire system. I'll use this slide because it's like probably one of the most used Drupal slides. This is the Drupal learning curve. I don't know how many of you use Drupal already. So this is in comparison to other kind of CMSs, and you know, you've got like Joomla and WordPress, and Drupal learning curve is somewhere like this, and a lot of people kind of suffer a horrible death when they get near the top. Which is a real shame, because actually Drupal as a platform is built in such a way that you can actually be productive at any step along this way. You don't need to necessarily learn all of Drupal to be able to be productive with it and to actually be able to have an input with it. You know, you can have, obviously, your editorial team, they don't need to know how Drupal works to be able to use Drupal as a CMS. But you can also have site builders as well who are using, you know, drag and drop tools to actually reconfigure your site. Our product owner wasn't the developer, but he often used to help us out with site builds because he knew how to use panels, which is the drag and drop interface for site building. So that kind of, it meant that you didn't have to have all of these Drupal rock stars and ninjas who knew everything about it to actually still roll out new sites. So, as I was saying, this became a real barrier to adoption for non-Drupal teams. You know, you had guys who were used to using, you know, Node.js or something, and they might be front-end developers, they're just used to working with templates, maybe some JavaScript. All of a sudden, they needed to know how to spin up, you know, a virtual environment for local development. They needed to then know how the local CMS worked before they could start creating content to put in their local development environment. And that's partly, you know, due to a way that, I guess, a flaw in the design to the hub spoke model is that the hub was responsible for pushing all of this content out to all of the spokes, to all of the websites. But there was no real way of you getting a front-end website saying, I want to pull this content, you know. So a better way, I guess, you know, would, for refactoring that, would have made it more like a sort of a pub sub, what's called a pub sub model, where you have publishers and subscribers, so you can have front-end sites that actually pull the content that they need from their central hub, you know, central content hub. So yeah, it became really difficult, even for Drupal developers, to work within our system, because suddenly they needed to know, well, how does the CMS work? It's like, I don't care how the CMS works, I just want to work on the front end. But you need to know how the CMS works so that you can push the content into the front end and so you can do all of this development. Meanwhile, you know, all of these other teams, as I said, you know, they were still running on different technology stacks. They were running on Symfony, Node.js, Ruby, you know, WordPress, or the bespoke PHP framework. And the bespoke PHP framework that they were running from, you know, Comedy Central out of New York, even though this was kind of 8 years old, they continually evolved this. So they'd moved away from all of their procedural code, they started using object-oriented stuff, it moved into more of a sort of microservices kind of framework rather than building these monoliths. We were still running Drupal 7, which at the time was approaching like 5 years old, or 5 years since its official release. So, we were desperately trying to sell, I guess, Drupal and the technology, and not just Drupal as a product, but I guess the sort of, you know, the ethos behind it, the whole sort of collaborative platform versus a silo platform, you know, collaborative approach to solving problems rather than just keeping it within your own team or within your own head. The solutions presented to us in a dream. So, Drupal 8 really became this kind of solution that we wanted to adopt a lot of the difference between Drupal 7 and Drupal 8 is that Drupal 8 is kind of built on a Symfony framework, and it's more about sort of interoperability between other platforms. So you can have sort of PHP components that work with Symfony as well as Drupal, and it's not just, you don't, is like you don't just need to know how to use Drupal to be able to use Drupal. You can come from other PHP frameworks, and it's a little bit more open to outsiders coming in. It is a lot more complex, but in different ways. So this solution really was a little bit too late. We never actually got around to sort of building Drupal 8, unfortunately. While we'd sort of still been shoring up, the issues that we'd had with Drupal 7, a lot of the time that was spent, debugging and keeping the system running. We didn't actually, we were too late to make this move to Drupal 8. So ultimately, the bespoke PHP framework and I think Node.js were the platforms that ended up winning out across Viacom. Drupal is still in use across Viacom International, and it's still the same platform that's sort of running up. I think it's about a year now since I left. But a lot of the stuff that we put in place is still running. But it was a little bit too late, so I had to. So I'm trying not to be too negative there. Andre was talking about the person who sits in the room and who sort of finds the problems and everything, and sort of the slightly negative one. I tended to be that one in my previous role. But I think, I do think it's important to be reflective and to actually look back on, are you making the right decisions here, rather than having that confirmation bias that goes on. So being slightly positive. So a few conclusions that were sort of, from all of my experience here. Document everything. And not just don't just document what it is that you're building, but document why you're building something. Document decisions that you've made. Because there's so often, you come back to something, so, I don't understand this. Why has it been built this way? And once you spoke to the person who built it 3, 4, 5 years ago, you'd maybe understand, okay, this is why they've done that. If that person's left, you're screwed, and you haven't got an idea, and you're going to end up deleting that and just moving on. Automate everything that you can. So repeatable tasks. You should try to automate this. Build day for us, which used to happen once a fortnight. It was one person who used to sit there for an entire day, probably 10 hours, doing a release across the entire network, sitting there waiting for a build to finish by hand, making sure there are no errors, and then move on to the next site. Once we automated this, we moved into sort of more continuous integration kind of model, and developers became responsible for doing their own releases, and it was just a huge soar in productivity. Avoid monolithic architecture, I'd say, is a huge thing, especially if you're building large complex systems. Large complex systems, break them into smaller, much more manageable chunks. Ideally, you need to be at a point where you don't need to understand the entire system to still be able to contribute to that system. So there's a lot of talk about headless Drupal. This is a prime example of it. Separating your front end, your presentation layer, from the content management side, from the back end, which enables, doing something like that, it enables non-Drupal developers to still contribute to the platform that you're using. They don't have to understand the guts and the nuts and bolts of everything that's happening there. They're just sort of working with these front end, templates and that kind of stuff. Make that data migration a first class system. I probably didn't talk about that enough earlier, but data migration has always been the biggest headache in any kind of rebuild project or any onboarding project. It needs to be a first class citizen. You need to be thinking about this up front, doing your content modeling right at the very start of it, and start your data migration before you start building any features that are going to be using that data. You have to get that up there. And making sure you can do top-up migrations as well. Invest in your team. I think we were actually quite lucky within MTV, UK, Viacom UK, in that we had a lot of support from our local senior management. And it's not always about hiring rock stars and ninjas and that kind of stuff. It's about hiring the right people for the job, hiring people who are going to analyze the problem and work out the best solution to fix it, rather than as Andre was saying about that sort of the instinct to just throw a solution quickly against something. Try to find people who aren't necessarily the most sort of experienced in terms of skill. They might not you know, we've been working on, you know, PHP platforms for, you know, 10, 15, 20 years or whatever. But having that right kind of attitude, you know, the ability to actually analyze a problem and find solutions is crucial. And giving them space to kind of learn and grow and experiment as well, you know, allow people to make the wrong decision. And, you know, using this sort of agile approach obviously, you know, makes it much easier to, I guess, make the wrong decision and hopefully recover from it, because you're doing small iterations towards a platform. And if something goes wrong, you can kind of change course. It's important to be able to make mistakes, you know, because you're never really going to get anything right first time. Sometimes you do, and, you know, sometimes you do get lucky, but if you become scared of making the wrong decision, you have this decision paralysis, and then you have that tendency, as Achor was saying, I keep referring back to his talk, but you kind of foster that culture where people don't want to point out mistakes. You know, people, what is the conspiracy of silence that kind of happens? And I think it's important to involve your team in decision making as well. Even though, you know, I talked about some of the reasons why I thought you know, Drupal or Drupal 8 wasn't adopted across Viacom as an organisation, there were probably much bigger decisions in play that I just wasn't part of. You know, I was relatively low down the food chain in terms of those kind of decision making. You know, so there were probably, you know, factors, you know, that involved the fact that, you know, it was a broadcast corporation that had, you know, enormous systems that you know, that were running, you know, all of the broadcast infrastructure and legal and finance kind of structures and everything that that all needs to be integrated with. I think, you know, partly as well, there was a certain culture within Viacom US of building their own things. You know, as a broadcast company, they used to build their own playout setups, which to me sounds insane, but I'm kind of sold on sort of using community software. But there was, you know, I think involving your team in those kind of decisions at least means that they understand why you're making these decisions, rather than, you know, going, you people are crazy, I don't understand why you're doing this, which used to happen quite a lot. And finally, I'd say, you know, contribution to the community, I think, is key, really. It's actually, contribution is a really good way to learn a system, rather than just using it. You know, going back to, you know, DrupalCon Boston 2008, when I first sort of became involved with the community, that to me was invaluable as a learning experience, because it allowed me to sort of talk to, you know, core contributors and end users of Drupal as well. You know, all of the different people that were using Drupal in slightly different ways, that had all of these slightly different use cases to how they wanted to build something. You know, it's it meant that. I'll use an example. From Viacom, there was an internal content management system that was all built on Adobe Flex, which I don't know if anyone remembers this. It's kind of a Java-based browser sort of thing, terrible nastiness. But we, you know, when we started showing them the Drupal 5 tools that we were using in this kind of drag and drop functionality and everything, they were kind of amazed by this. It's like, this is incredible. And they come back a year later and say, okay, we've done some upgrades, we've got that drag and drop thing that you've asked for. And it was kind of a little bit alien to us, because we got so used to doing the whole, like, okay, you know, how do we solve this? Okay, let's look on Drupal, is there a module for this already? Yes, there is. You know, chances are, probably 9 times out of 10, if not more, that you will find a Drupal module where someone has solved that particular problem for you and you can use it. You may need to customize it a little bit for your use case. But if you look at, like, you know, Drupal.org, there's tens of thousands of contributed modules on there, and they're not just modules of code. These are solutions to problems that other people have found and said, I've solved this problem. This is here you go. You don't have to resolve this exact same problem again. And so contribution could be really great for learning as well. As an example, just a final example. About 2 days ago, I was working on. A Drupal site for one of our clients, and ran into a problem where the database would start crashing every time they tried to insert an emoji. And it might have even been the poo emoji, I can't remember. I spent a few hours sort of trying to diagnose this and try and work out what was going wrong. I'd worked around the problem when I was at Viacom just by stripping out all the emojis. But I did some hunting around StarCam with a transolver this time. I spent a few hours kind of Googling and looking on different forums and all of this kind of stuff. And I finally found the solution to it in a thread that I'd created 2 years ago on Drupal.org, which is the first issue that I contributed to on Drupal 8. And it was to do with UTF-8 MB4 character set, so the ability for the database to support multi-byte characters, which is what emojis are. So yeah, it turned out that I'd actually found a solution 2 years ago, contributed to the community, and then found that same solution for myself 2 years later. So I guess like that, I think that in a nutshell really is how contributing to the community can really help. You know, you're not just helping other people, you're actually helping yourself. You know, if you build your own platforms and your own software within a silo, once you don't need that anymore, that's, you know, RM minus RF, that it's going to go straight in the delete bin, and you're never going to see that code again. You know, but actually contributing out to the community, it will even give back to yourself in a few years' time when you need it. I think that's about it. Sorry if it was a little bit disjointed, but. Any questions?
Thanks so much, Paul. Right, this time we've got a mic for questions, so I will do the roving.
Thank you very much, Paul. If you could go back in the time machine to 2008, what would you tell the previous version of yourself based on your thinking right now?
Definitely don't hack a core, never hack a core or Drupal. I think it would be, I guess collaboration, I think, was the key thing, you know, because I'd spent so long sort of being the one who sort of builds your own systems and not really working with other people and, you know, being the one who comes up with a solution to a problem. I think collaboration would be the main thing that I would have told myself back then. Make sure you're collaborating with other people. Make sure you're working with people who know vastly more than you do, you know, which is what invariably happens when you sort of get involved in a community like Drupal, is that there's incredibly smart people there who know so much more than you do. And you can, you know, learn by their examples, you can learn from some of the mistakes that they've made, but also, you know, amazing solutions that they've had to problems. So yeah, definitely collaborate more.
We got
any
over here.
Hi there. So just interested, if you look back, when should Drupal have not been the answer? Because we've got something like 1,700 Drupal sites, some very complex distributions in there as well. Mm. And we're in the danger of Drupal being the answer to everything, when I know it shouldn't be. So just interested in some of your thoughts now.
I've been in that exact same position before. And in fact, in Viacom, like, I think I'm pretty sure there was some senior management at Viacom that were just saying, please just stop talking about Drupal, because we used to use it for literally everything. You know, we had it sort of powering, you know, TV systems and graphic systems and that kind of stuff. If you're managing content, then Drupal is a perfect solution for it. You know, and if you're not managing content, then maybe that's the point where you should say, should I be using a content management system? You know, things like static sites or microsites, you know, if your content is very rarely, if ever, going to be changed, I would question using any kind of, any kind of sort of content management system for it. You know? So, and I think that was the idea behind the way that we wanted to move within Drupal 8, is that we wanted to sort of build this ecosystem of components that could work together to solve, you know, to solve the problem, rather than having this enormous sledgehammer and everything looking like a nail. You would have this kind of toolkit of, you know, you can have a front-end, you know, sort of theme that isn't necessarily dependent on any one particular platform that you might be able to use for static sites, microsites, or whatever. But then, if you wanted to have, you know, some more sort of complex application logic behind it, you might actually use that front-end theme with, you know, Symfony or Laravel or, you know, something like that. And then you could upgrade it again. So, okay, if you want full content management, you could use that same front-end theme and the same components and kind of use it within Drupal in a fully sort of managed, you know, content management environment. So, I think it's specifically talking about Drupal, for sure that, you know, if you're using sort of content management systems, or if you have some sort of administration system that you're going to be building that's storing that, you know, storing configuration or something, then Drupal could be a good candidate for it. But I think, you know, if you can move towards that sort of interoperability, it means you haven't got to suddenly completely ditch Drupal and use something totally different. You know, you can kind of still have these familiar tools and use the right one appropriately. Does that help? Yeah, it makes sense.
Thank you. You know, you described a lot of websites across languages, continents, and, you know, it looks like a really complex task for sort of projects. But what were the, you know, the biggest challenges that you have that is not related, you know, to technical difficulties, like, for example, content producing or, you know, hierarchies in the organization? You know, what are the biggest hurdles that you had while working on all of these projects, and what were the solutions or lessons that were learned?
From a technical perspective, it's definitely data migration, as I said before. During the initial build of the platform, we were only, you know, we were only migrating one site over to this platform, which is MTV UK. Ended up being an 18-month project. At least 6-7 months of that was spent working on data migration. And we found that we'd build things, and then we'd migrate data in, and actually the things we'd build were completely inappropriate, and we'd have to go back and do it all over again. So data migration for sure. The multilingual stuff actually ended up being surprisingly easy to work on. You know, Drupal has excellent multilingual support, so I think one of the more complex ones working with MTV Israel, which was all in, you know, it was all Hebrew right to left, and none of us read Hebrew. And so that became quite difficult to actually work out what the hell it was that we were building, and, you know, is if everything was actually working the way it was, you know, supposed to. But yeah, for sure, at a technical level, data migration was by far the biggest.
I thought when you were talking about all the components with minor variations that you were dealing with, I was wondering if you found a way to use something like StarCraft to draw the film. I think that would be a modern
No, I mean, style guide-driven development, I think, is exactly the way that we wanted to go, and we never quite got there with it. We were working towards it, and we sort of started iterating towards this. But yeah, using style guide-driven development, I think, is key to you know, having this building a large system. I think, you know, you can't. I think I dread the day when I ever have to work on another project where I get presented with 20, 30, 40 Photoshops of complete looking pages. You know, when you're designing a platform, you're not designing pages, you're designing a system. You know, you're designing a system of components of how your is going to be presented. And you know, having a final PDF of what a page is going to look like, I think is no way to start a project, for sure.
I've seen some stuff talked about people using KSS to try and kind of automate that process. And I just wondered if you recommend that people particularly talk about.
I don't have any personal experience with it, I'm afraid. So yeah, it was always that, you know, we knew that it was the place that we wanted to be at, but we unfortunately didn't quite make it that far.
Right, I think there's also one more question.
Any from Twitter?
No, we're going to put the hashtags up. I think they're just about up at the moment. So
yes, if you can read tiny writing, please use the hashtags and continue the conversation online. But thank you so much for your time.
Yeah,
thank you.
Welcome.